In this comic book is a love story. A boy and girl in love. They get married, and after an offensively lurid description, illustrated, of course, of the couple's wedding night, the book shows how the bride murders her husband by chopping his head off with an axe. This comic book describes a sexual aberration so shocking that I couldn't mention even the scientific term on television. I think there ought to be a law against them. Tonight I'm going to show you why.
It has been said that art imitates life and has been used as a metaphor for the human experience, often foreshadowing the things to come. The superhero, beings with incredible powers coming from another world, often honored as divinity, personifying a savior of humanity. They are gods in spandex.
You wrote that the world doesn't need a savior, but every day I hear people crying for one.
We can save this world with the right leadership.
Historically, these mythological stories have been used as propaganda in an effort to gain sympathy for social and political parties. Purposely creating characters to facilitate civil justice, being at the forefront of various movements as a voice of liberation. Superhero mania continues to explode with each passing decade, gaining momentum as one of the most powerful genres of storytelling. Millions of adoring fans pour into theaters to escape into the fantasy world of their favorite masked gods.
And to many, it's irrelevant what this movie is about. They will tell you this movie is a happening unto itself.
Iron Man just missed being the biggest non-sequel debut movie in history for the first Spider-Man movie, which tallied 114 million.
Are they borrowing their inspiration from the Bible, only showing you a very different side of the story? With such spiritual themes, is there an agenda to replace your worship of the one true God? One of the great American innovations of the 20th century is the sanctity of childhood. Countless billions are spent on making the modern childhood 24/7 Disneyland of indulgence and delight. Refashioning what was once considered sacred, a youthful innocence, and replacing it with a dehumanized, overly commercialized society. It wasn't always like this up until the 1930s. Kids mostly played outdoors. The television hadn't become a household item yet, and there were no video games to consume their time. But in the midst of the Great Depression, a new pastime sprung to life. The golden age of comics, a new medium of storytelling that quickly became an iconic obsession. One of the reasons for its timely success was the dawn of the Second World War, which brought fear and anxiety to the general public. And superheroes arose to the occasion, providing a means of comfort and escape. Superman, one of the most notorious heroes, didn't fight aliens or evil robots in his earliest adventures. He battled the villains that people were genuinely worried about most. Gangsters, corrupt politicians, fascists, and war profiteers. And after the Pearl Harbor disaster, superheroes became the mascot of the war effort. Comic books enjoyed circulations in the millions and became essential reading material for the GIs overseas. The story is as old as time. The only occasion we call in a god is when we are in need of him. When life is easy, we forget our need of a savior. The prophetic books of the Bible are riddled with examples of how Israel called upon Jehovah only to save them from total annihilation. In the same way, comic book fans seem to turn their attention to these colorful gods only when there is a genuine threat to society at large. For example, the comic boom in the late 1980s, brought on by Batmania, was a time that urban America was bombarded with a crack epidemic and an explosion of gang violence. Comic book creators responded to the New York Post headlines with their four colored vigilantes who went to work against the drug gangs, smugglers, and other assorted street thugs, even going as far as to portray an anti-drug stance in their cover art. The happy-go-lucky years of the Clinton administration, however, saw one of the greatest declines of comic circulation, which had brought the comic industry to their knees. This would all change in a single instance. September 11, 2001. There was a brief moment in time when the dust was settling from the falling Twin Towers that it seemed like real life was being taken straight off the pages of a comic strip. It was suddenly us against them. There were good guys and bad guys, villains and victims. The comic industry responded. The events of 9/11 tapped into a deep-seated need of someone or something to save us from the faceless, nameless evil that had incredible power to extinguish life at will. The kind of destruction previously seen only in comic books. Once again, the comic industry picked up steam and rebounded with unprecedented success. They supplied a confused, terror-driven nation with superheroes who would put things to right, saving them from the tyrannical powers at hand. So if real-life events have a direct link to the type of content that the comic industry is feeding to the masses, what is so bad about having these savior types be our heroes? Isn't Jesus Christ one of these types of heroes that has come to our world to save us from some unspeakable evil, to fight the ultimate foe and save his girl, a metaphor for the church, from Satan's arms? Is there something wrong with paralleling the great controversy between Christ and Satan? Or could these allegories be misleading? Could these be counterfeits of the great story of salvation and redemption, meant to detour you away from the truth? Subtly weaving characteristics of ancient gods into each superhero, ultimately convincing the world that Satan is our hero. How do these comic stories intersect with the Bible? And is the effect of watching, reading, or idolizing these heroes damaging to your faith and belief in the God of heaven? In order to understand these parallels, we must take a look at the origins of both superheroes and Jesus Christ. Every culture has had its superheroes. When the difference between life and death often came to the strongest and the bravest, it was only natural that the retelling of these accounts were passed on throughout the generations, each story becoming more fantastical, which became the building blocks for elaborate tales of super gods. One of the earliest known depictions of a hero was that of Gilgamesh, the Sumerian. Detailed exploits of a pantheon of deities have been discovered on Sumerian tablets, telling stories of human acting gods. Linguist and longtime researcher of the Sumerian culture, Zachariah Sitchin, has spent his life studying these myths.
A basic conclusion of my writings has been that those who gave mankind civilization were visitors to Earth from another planet. If I say extraterrestrials, it's a dirty word, but that's what they were.
In Sitchin's book, The 12th Planet, he claims that they really aren't myths at all, but rather garbled accounts of extraterrestrial beings who were sent to Earth and enslaved the human race. An interesting observation, considering the biblical account of a foreign race, of beings who were cast out of heaven and enslaved the human race. The Sumerian goods and technologies, as well as their writings, traveled to other parts of the world through trading. Egypt, being their closest trading partner, exchanged goods and services as well as ideas and culture. Ancient Egypt was a society almost as saturated in media as our own. Cultural artifacts were inseparable from their religious context. Hieroglyphs and picture writings on the walls of ancient tombs can be seen as a precursor to modern comic strips. The Egyptians worshipped a vast array of colorful gods, which they called the Netjir, attaining their inspiration from the nature around them. Some believe that the word nature is actually a Latin adaptation. Their esoteric religion focused heavily on the next world, which is death judgment, and the afterlife. For this reason, they fashioned the god Osiris, lord of the underworld. In fact, the comic book world draws heavily from Egyptology and uses themes as well as reincarnations of these ancient deities. Osiris sat in judgment of the dead and determined whether they went to paradise or whether their souls were destroyed. The whole Bible-believing Christian world also teaches of an afterlife, a God that will judge what the final fate of each soul will be and who will be counted amongst the saints in paradise. But one paramount difference is that Osiris is the god of the underworld, for example, below, and the god of the Bible is from heaven above. Nevertheless, Osiris was overshadowed by his sister and wife, Isis, who served many functions and has morphed over time by absorbing those of earlier goddesses. Isis was the mother of Horus, the hawk-headed god of kings. He was the god of the sun, the sky, and the horizons, which derive from the name Horus stones, as some scholars believe. Horus was a star of one of the first action-adventure dramas during the 20th dynasty, titled The Contendings of Horus and Set. Set was responsible for sending Osiris into the underworld, both battling it out for kingship of Egypt like two comic book heroes. The two gods shapeshift, race boats of stone, and maim each other until Horus becomes victorious and rules the throne. The outcome of the struggle was so important that it dictated Egyptian life. Thus, in the afterlife, every king is an incarnation of Horus, and in death becomes a new Osiris. The Bible also speaks of a great battle between Christ and Satan.
And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought, and his angels, and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven.
A war in which the three main players are God, the judge, Jesus, God's son, and the dragon, or Satan, who is defeated and becomes associated with death, or the king of the dead. Both accounts having almost identical players, Osiris and Horus, which are father and son, who fought against the evil enemy, Set. Only there is one stark contrast between Osiris and the god of the Bible. Osiris is the god of the dead, and the god of heaven is the god of the living. In biblical terms, Osiris is more like Satan. Today, Egypt's power over the popular imagination is undiminished. We see Egyptian iconography everywhere, from the back of the dollar bill, to Fortune 500 logos, to blockbuster movie characters. The trinity of Osiris, Isis, and Horus became central to the Hellenistic mystery cults and have been deeply rooted in the foundations of the secret orders such as Freemasonry and Rosicrucianism. Esoterics from around the world have sought to resurrect the Egyptian mysteries so that the power that once built those inexplicable monuments could be harnessed again. The early Greeks and Romans essentially worshipped the same pantheon as the Egyptians, albeit under different names. Zeus, Poseidon, Hercules, and Hades all starred in fanciful dramas that were depicted in murals, friezes, poems, and statues. The gods fought epic battles against their predecessors, the Titans, and later interacted with humans in allegorical parables. The epic myths of the Greeks all centered around these godlike superheroes. The outcome of the Trojan War hinged not on the armies of Greece and Troy, but on the mighty warriors of Hector and Achilles. Cult-like worship developed around these gods. Writings like Homer's epic poem, The Odyssey, were revered and fashioned like the scriptures are to Christians. Each god was assigned mastery over a specific art or science or facet of nature. Their icons and images persist to this day, especially in our modern art forms such as movies and comics. The far-reaching influence of these gods have gained momentum through the years, becoming the subjects of a wide range of media. And yet one thing remains consistent, that there is a war between the gods, and salvation comes from a savior who is part God and part man. This is apparent in the movie Immortals.
Long before man roamed these lands, there was a war in heaven. The victors declared themselves gods, while the vanquished were renamed Titans and forever imprisoned within the bowels of Mount Tartarus. King Hyperion and his legions seek to unleash the Titans and wage war upon this world.
I will end the reign of the gods.
If there is one human who could lead them against Hyperion, it would be Theseus.
Let's analyze what you just saw. The victors of this war in heaven, known as the gods, are depicted as coming down from heaven, ordained in gold, reminiscent of the biblical God of heaven. The titans whom war against the gods are chained and confined to the earth. A quasi-depiction of devils with degenerating skin. And the Savior comes through the seed of man to redeem humanity. Once again, a myth having the same elements as the biblical account of God's plan of salvation. As it says in the first book of Samuel 2, verse 10,
"The adversaries of the Lord shall be broken to pieces. Out of heaven shall be thunder upon them. The Lord shall judge the ends of the earth, and he shall give strength unto his king, and exalt the horn of his anointed."
You see, the God of the Bible is in heaven. His adversaries, cast out of it, are chained to the bowels of the earth.
"And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him."
Theseus, the savior from the Immortals movie, is a type of Christ, being half human and half God. Poseidon is his father. According to Carl A. P. Ruck's book, The World of Classical Myth, Theseus battled and overcame foes that were identified with an archaic religious and social order. He was known as a great reformer. But he wasn't like the Christ in the Bible. Rather, he was a ruthless warrior who killed many, was a seducer of women, and established the cult worship of Aphrodite. Although it may seem that the Greek myths have parallels to the Bible, could they be telling a vastly opposing account of the great war between Christ and Satan? Let's examine another film that was released, called Clash of the Titans. This will start to unfold the twisting of the biblical plan of salvation.
The oldest stories ever told are written in the stars. Stories of time before man and gods, when titans ruled the earth. The titans were powerful, but their reign was ended by their own sons, Zeus, Poseidon, and Hades. Zeus convinced his brother Hades to create a beast so strong it could defeat their parents. And from his own flesh, Hades gave birth to an unspeakable horror, the Kraken. Zeus became king of the heavens, Poseidon king of the seas, and Hades, tricked by Zeus, was left to rule the underworld in darkness and in misery. It was Zeus who created man, and man's prayers fed the gods' immortality. But in time, mankind grew restless. They began to question the gods, and finally rise up against them. Into this world, a child was born. A boy who would change everything.
Question must be raised. Why do the ancient myths have so many similarities to the accounts of the Bible, even if the myths predate the birth of Christ? The movie even goes as far as introducing the Savior boy alone with his mother, intending it to be a gross misrepresentation of Christ Jesus with the Virgin Mary.
The name of the Savior boy is Perseus, which the name derives from an ancient Greek verb, Perthian. According to Carl Darling Buck, in the book Comparative Grammar of the Greek and Latin, the eos suffix is typically used to form an agent noun. In this case, Perseus means to waste, ravage, sack, and destroy. This is the exact opposite of the Savior Jesus Christ.
For the Son of Man is not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. The thief comes to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life, and that they may have it more abundantly.
Perseus does, however, share a common thread with Christ, in that he is half human, half God. Actor Liam Neeson, who plays Zeus, explains.
And then he learns through his journey that he is the son of Zeus. He's half God. And he decides to fight against it. He wants to be a man and defend himself and go through life as a man, and has no respect for these gods.
Actor Sam Worthington even uses terminology associated with that of Jesus' mission on earth.
And this movie is also about revenge, which means the second movie should be about redemption and forgiveness.
Except for that Christ was not here for revenge. So if this heroine savior, whose name means to waste, ravage, and destroy, is quite literally opposite of Jesus Christ, who then is his father, Zeus? Is he also an opposing counterfeit of the biblical God of heaven?
I'm Zeus, the king of the gods, and he formed, fashioned, created human beings for his pleasure. And with these other gods, the god of war, Aphrodite, the god of love, the god of this, the god of nature, by creating human beings, his rationale was, these are my little playthings, and if they pray enough, honor us gods enough, we will become immortal. So their food is human prayer.
It sounds like Zeus could be a description of the biblical Yahweh, but this couldn't be farther from the truth. Zeus is known as the king or prince of the air, according to Ephesians 2:2, so is Satan.
Wherein, in time past, ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience.
In Pergamum, perpetual sacrifices were offered to Zeus upon his towering and famous 40-foot-high tall altar, the same artifact that now stands inside the Berlin Museum. Antipas, the first leader and martyr of the early Christian church in Pergamum, was slain for resisting this altar worship of Zeus. Tradition holds that Antipas was slowly burned to death inside the statue of a bull, the symbol and companion of Zeus. The passage in Revelation 2:13 could very well be a reference to the cult worship of Zeus.
I know thy works, and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is, wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you, where Satan dwelleth.
The argument could be made for a Pergamum connection between Zeus and the biblical Satan, as both were considered descending gods of thunder. Zeus in antiquity and Satan at the beginning of time. Altars dedicated to Zeus Katavatis were discovered near Pergamum. Zeus Katavatis most accurately means Zeus who descends. Reminiscent of Jesus who said,
I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven.
As you can see, the stories have striking similarities to the Bible.
A son battles his father for control of the universe and seizes more power than any god ever had. This is the story of Zeus, Greek mythology's supreme commander. To us, it's a myth, but to the ancients, it was reality.
Lucifer, the covering cherub, battled for control of the universe.
I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds.
An interesting parallel, as Zeus sits on top of a mountain above the clouds. And since the devil wants to be God, it makes sense why he would counterfeit the things of God.
Zeus is no stranger to cannibalism. His own father, Cronus, once swallowed all of Zeus's siblings. When he is confronted with the sight of mortals doing the same thing, he becomes enraged and with a catastrophic flood. Nine days and nights pass. The rain is relentless, and the earth slowly drowns. The waters reach the peak of Mount Parnassus, which stands over 8,000 feet high. When the rain stops, only two mortals are still alive. Incredibly, they have survived the storm by building an ark. A raging flood, an ark, and only two surviving humans. The parallels with the Old Testament are...
Another ironic biblical parallel is Zeus's son, the half-god, half-mortal man, Hercules. A counterfeit of Jesus Christ.
His story begins with Zeus, the sex-crazed king of the gods, having an illicit affair.
Hercules is the son of Zeus and a mortal woman named Alcmene.
Classical mythology is loaded with stories of gods who impregnate mortal women and give birth to.
So this demigod idea means that this person has some features that are very godly, some divine powers, but at the same time, he...
Hercules' final act is one of self-sacrifice. And again, there's an interesting Christian parallel with the hero who has to suffer to obtain immortality.
His life on Earth ends just as he endured it. In torment.
He wants to have a heroic death. The proper death of a hero. He wants to burn on a funeral pyre. Well, when this happens, it seems to be the final cleansing. What burns away is not Hercules. What burns away is his mortal flesh, and this releases his soul. So he himself ascends to the heavens.
In death, Hercules is finally redeemed. Zeus, the king of gods, believes his son has suffered enough. He invites him to join the...
What we see here, I think, is that Hercules is the hero of heroes. He's the greatest of the great. And at the very end of it all, Zeus says, okay, Hercules, you've suffered enough, and you're so great, I'm actually going to go ahead and just make you a god. Hercules is finally going to get a kind of reward that will last forever. The suffering's finally over.
In the end, Hercules is resurrected and joins his father in the Eternal Kingdom. It is an ending with an eerie similarity to another divine mortal.
This Clash of the Gods documentary went through many of the world's greatest myths and revealed astounding similarities to the Bible.
The legend of Beowulf is a fictional story inspired by fact. Today, experts are still unsure who created it, but it's believed to have originated in England in the 7th or 8th century AD.
The action of the poem takes place in the 6th century in Scandinavia. But the poem itself was written in Anglo-Saxon England after the conversion of the Anglo-Saxons in 665.
Christianity had recently taken root in England at the time of the writing of Beowulf. The poem reflects a society that has a deep pagan background and that has stories that come from its pagan past. What the poem does is it recasts these stories in a Christian mold so that its listeners would be able to keep touch with their past. They would reinterpret it in a Christian way.
Hercules must go to the edge of the world to steal golden apples from a garden guarded by a dragon with 100 heads. Apples, a garden, and a dangerous serpent. This labor parallels the biblical story. Historical sources inspired not only Middle Earth's most despised fiends, but also one of its principal heroes, the wizard Gandalf. In The Lord of the Rings, Gandalf guides Frodo in his quest to destroy the One Ring.
Gandalf has also been compared by some people to Jesus. He sacrifices himself, is dead, and
as Gandalf battles to save Frodo, he metaphorically dies and is resurrected as Gandalf the White. And this is one of the instances where we can see Tolkien's Catholic roots.
A pagan god of many disguises and a Christian savior who was resurrected. Two powerful figures from the ancient world, both seen in one main character.
This is what is so unique about Tolkien. He is very good at bringing together Christian and pagan motif.
The religious influences behind The Lord of the Rings are fully revealed in the climax of the epic. As the story concludes, it is not Gandalf, but Frodo who is in a position to save the world. A close comparison of the Odyssey and the Gospel of Mark reveals some shocking parallels. Both stories revolve around the hardships of a suffering hero, Odysseus and Jesus. Both main characters have carpentry backgrounds. Odysseus was a skilled woodworker who even built his own palace in Ithaca. Jesus was the son of a carpenter, and in one passage in the book of Mark, he himself is referred to as the carpenter. But the most intriguing connection is the similarity between Odysseus's visit to Hades and Jesus's last days on earth. Both stories begin with a banquet. Odysseus and his men feasting at Circe's palace.
When Odysseus learns from Circe that he needs to go to Hades, he despairs of it. And the reason is, and he says so, that no mortal has ever gone to Hades and returned. Jesus is about to die. He has a Last Supper with his disciples. He despairs of life because he knows he must face the cross.
Ultimately, Odysseus would travel to the underworld of the dead and return. Jesus would die on the cross and then rise to new life. Could these parallels be more than coincidence?
Could it be that all these myths, stories, and legends are simply the devil's way of confusing the truth about God, his plan of redemption, and the quest for our restoration? No myths found prior to the 2nd century AD have any resurrected gods. Only the ones found after have records of these ancient gods coming back to life. The earliest complete copy of the Odyssey only dates back to the 10th century AD, which means the similarities could have easily been written in after Christ's death. Yet the fact still remains that there are similarities, such as coming saviors born of virgin mothers, worldwide floods, heavens and hells, that have existed in the myths since the beginning. The reason for this is because the promise of a coming savior dates all the way back to the beginning, with our first parents in the Garden of Eden. When Adam and Eve sinned, it was promised that a savior would come through the woman's seed. God said to the serpent,
"And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel."
Ever after, the descendants of God's people looked forward to the day that a Savior would come and redeem the lost. And since that day in the Garden of Eden, the devil has sought to counterfeit the prophecy of the coming Savior. A pattern that is found in almost every great civilization since the earliest recorded writings. It is for this reason many skeptics debate the existence of God. But there is one marked difference in all the Savior patterns: the fact that the Savior in the Bible, Jesus Christ, died and was resurrected again.
Virtually all scholars agree that Jesus of Nazareth lived in the first century, preached about the kingdom of God, and was crucified. But what happened next is the most controversial issue of history. Did Jesus rise from the dead and thus authenticate his claim to being the Son of God? Or is this the stuff of legend and mythology? For Christians, everything hinges on the resurrection. And today we're going to debate whether there's sufficient evidence to back it up. Joining me is Tim Callahan, religion editor of Skeptic Magazine and author of Secret Origins of the Bible, and Dr. Gary Habermas, who's considered one of the world's leading authorities on the resurrection. He chairs the philosophy and theology department at Liberty University, has written several books on the resurrection, his most recent being The Case for the Resurrection of Jesus. Well, Tim, let me start with you. In your book, you suggest that the resurrection of Jesus isn't original at all, but it's merely a story that was recycled from earlier mythology and mystery religions. You specifically in your book mention the stories of Osiris, Adonis, and Attis. Could you explain what all this means?
Well, the resurrection is, there were death and resurrection stories going all the way back, as you said, to Isis and Osiris, and usually in Dionysus, in out of the Greek mythology, became his own separate cult, and in all of these, they die an excruciating death of some sort. Dionysus is torn to pieces and eaten by the Titans, and then they rise physically from the dead.
So you're saying that this Jesus story then is just a recapitulation of this earlier mythology?
Well, not necessarily exactly a recapitulation, but I think that basically the evidence for it is lacking.
Okay. Dr. Habermas, what's your response to that?
Let's take Adonis. Adonis is probably the ancient god for which we have the clearest data that he was raised from the dead. We have four accounts that Adonis was raised. The earliest one is the 2nd century AD. The other ones are between the 2nd and 4th century AD. The earliest account we have for Attis is the 3rd century AD. And while Isis and Osiris, as a religion, was definitely pre-Christian, there is no resurrection in Isis and Osiris. Osiris in particular is not raised.
Okay, Tim, how do you respond to that?
I would point out that oftentimes the only copies of the myths we have are quite late as far as writings go, but quite often we have some evidence of the myths in the form of pictures on vases of the various mythic characters and the situations of the myths. So we can be pretty sure that they were being told orally a lot earlier.
Go ahead, Dr. Abrams.
If we're talking about stories on vases or in other reliefs, there are still no resurrection. There are no resurrected gods for which we have influence, for which we have data prior to the second century.
There are upwards of 100 messianic prophecies in the Old Testament foretelling the life of Christ. The likelihood of a man fulfilling just 8 of those prophecies is 1 in 10, with 17 zeros behind it. Israel, God's chosen people, were promised through Abraham that the Savior of the world would be of Jewish descent. The entire sacrificial system pointed forward to this day. But after 400-year enslavement to the ancient Egyptian Empire, Israel began to soak in the esoteric superstitions of the mystery cults. They were then freed by the miraculous hand of God and led into the Promised Land, eventually building the great city of Jerusalem at the crossroads of the Mediterranean. In 217 BC, shortly after the reign of Alexander the Great, Israel found itself under the control of the Greeks. The ruler Ptolemy Philopator made a decree that all of Israel had to sacrifice to the Greek gods, or they would be demoted to slave status. As Israel sank lower in the ranks of society, and by the time Rome rose to power, the Israelites' desire for a savior became focused on one that would save them from their oppressors. Which is why when Jesus Christ came in a lowly, humble manner to save them from their sins, they didn't recognize him. They were looking for a kingly hero, much like Perseus or Theseus, who would lead them in a revolution against the world's tyrants, establishing Israel as the world's superior political power and bringing about an age of peace. Even to this day, the Jewish nation is still awaiting this type of Messiah to appear.
Is Jesus the Messiah, the anointed one sent by the Father to be the Savior of Israel and the world? Christians believe that Jesus is the only one who has fulfilled the ancient prophecies in the Hebrew Scriptures or the Old Testament of the Bible, and this establishes his messianic credentials. But most Jewish people disagree. They say the Messiah has not yet come. But where does the evidence really point? We're going to debate that tonight with Dr. Michael Brown. He's president of the Fire School of Ministry in North Carolina and the author of more than 15 books, including a 3-volume series called Answering Jewish Objections to Jesus. And here's Rabbi Shmuley Boteach, author of Face Your Fear, syndicated columnist, and according to Talkers Magazine, one of the 100 most important radio hosts in America. Michael, what is the Messiah? What does that mean? And why do you believe Jesus is the Messiah?
The concept of Messiah comes from the Hebrew word Mashiach, which means anointed one. And over a period of time, God revealed to our people Israel in the scriptures, not my opinion or your opinion, because there are different branches of Judaism and different opinions within Judaism and different groups, and there are atheistic Jews and very traditional Jews and Reformed Jews, and everyone has a different view. The one sure thing we have is what's written in the Word, and over a period of time, God spoke to us, to our forefathers, to the Jewish people, about the Messiah of Israel, that he would come and that he would die for the sins of his people, that he would be rejected by his people and yet embraced by the nations of the world, and that he would come and die and rise from the dead before the second temple was destroyed. If Jesus is not the Messiah, there can be none, because the second temple was destroyed over 1900 years ago. And the scriptures go on to say that he would have a priestly ministry, which is one of atonement, which is one of making people come back to God, reconciliation, just like happened with me, that through him the Gentiles, the knowledge of God would go to the Gentiles around the world, and then he in fact would be embraced by his own people and would return.
And Shmuley, why don't you believe that Jesus is the Messiah specifically?
Well, I believe that Jesus is the Christian Messiah in the sense that he brought divinity and redemption to the non-Jewish nations of the world, and Christianity is a great world religion. He is certainly not the Jewish Messiah, because the Jewish Messiah is a radically different notion to the Christian Messiah. The Jewish Messiah has a political mission as opposed to a spiritual mission. We don't need a God-man to bring us closer to God. We don't need an intermediary. God says clearly in the book of Samuel, he is not a man. It is absolute sacrilege in Judaism to believe that any human being is a deity. Also, and most importantly, the Messiah must fulfill the messianic prophecies, Isaiah 11. He must cause the wolf to lie with the lamb and change human nature away from belligerence and animosity, even animal nature. Isaiah chapter 2, he has to cause men to beat their swords into plowshares. He has to bring about universal dominion of peace.
Okay,
we live in a world of indiscriminate slaughter. We
let
live
Michael
in a
respond.
World... where there is no justice and the Messiah has not yet come.
Okay, Michael, what about the fact that we don't have the peace that Shmuley says was to be a prophecy for the coming of the Messiah?
Well, first he quoted some of the prophecies I firmly believe. He left out the other prophecies because Jesus fulfilled those, and only Jesus fulfilled those. For example, prophecies like Isaiah 42 and Isaiah 49 and Isaiah 50 and Isaiah 53, which speak of the suffering of the servant of the Lord and being rejected by his people and yet being accepted by the Gentile nations and bringing healing and redemption to those who believe in him. Shmuley also made the amazing statement that the Messiah's mission was political versus spiritual, and then he quotes all of these spiritual passages like Isaiah 11, which speak of the whole earth being filled with the knowledge of the glory of God, and Isaiah 2, which speak of all the nations streaming to the God of Israel. Of course it's a spiritual mission.
He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not.
Most of the world missed the Son of God, because they were looking for the wrong hero, worshiping strange idols and false gods. Paul says idols are actually demons.
The things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils and not to God. And I would not that ye have fellowship with devils. Ye cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils.
Satan was so successful in confusing the whole earth about the arrival of the greatest saving hero, the God of the universe, who left his royal throne in heaven to humbly save us from eternal death. By not recognizing who he was, we nailed him to a cross. Satan was victorious in blinding people from the greatest cosmic event simply by using mythological stories. What if he's doing the same thing again? Flash forward 2,000 years. Superheroes first appeared on the stands in 1933 in what is known today as the comic book. Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster were responsible for introducing the iconic Superman to the world. Basing the character off the German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche's Übermensch, the theory that there is no God, only a superior man. They originally created him to be a bald madman who used his telepathic abilities to wreak havoc on mankind. When World War II began, the Jewish writers decided to change Superman from an evil character into a good hero in hopes to conceal his German influence and make him more appealing to publishers. But at the story's core remained the Nietzschean philosophy that there is no
Batman, the Dark Knight detective, got his parents killed before him at an early age. He is the world's greatest detective, he's the world's greatest escape artist, and he's arguably the world's greatest hand-to-hand combatant. He also has $1 bazillion, and that's not somebody you want to go up against.
One of the reasons that Batman has been so popular for so long is his iconography is that of a demon. I mean, look at the paintings, of medieval paintings of devils in museums, the bat wings, the horns. He looks like something that's dark and evil, and his origins are in an act of murder, and yet he's on your side.
Wonder Woman is a perfect transition from the ancient myths. There are echoes of the Amazons in Homer's writing that refers to a tribe of women that lived without men, that were terrifyingly efficient soldier warriors.
Flash, the fastest man alive, can move at speeds near the speed of light, can outrace a bullet to its target, can run up the side of a building, can actually cross the ocean before he has time to sink.
There's the old Flash, and then there's the new Flash. The old Flash is the perfect counterpart for Hermes or Mercury in the old myths. You know it immediately when you see the helmet with the wings on it. It refers to the god of the messengers. In a fascinating way, the artists who are creating today's comics are doing heroic work by taking the timeless tales that began in the world of myth and bringing them into the future.
Are you with me?
Jack Kirby, an artist who drew the early Superman, states where he gets his inspiration.
For some reason, I went to the Bible. I came up with Galactus. And of course, the Silver Surfer is the fallen angel.
He has drawn for dozens of the top-selling comics, such as Fantastic Four, Thor, and Captain America. Take note of the spiritual themes in these stories. And since the comics are repackaged myths, it would make sense why he came up with a whole comic series titled New Gods.
What's up, guys? Thank you for joining us for Doco Tuesday. You're watching The Replacement Gods Part 1. This is actually a two-part series documentary.
Next week, we'll have Replacement Gods Part 2. And this is a very popular genre, superheroes are. I mean, chances are you've definitely seen one of the films that we talk about in here. But what you probably haven't thought about is the attack on God that these films portray.
Yeah, definitely share this video because every 1,000 views that this video gets, this digital download will be knocked off 10%. So 2,000 views, 20% off. Up to 9,000 views, making it 90% off. Cheaper than any Redbox.
That's right. In addition to that, we also will air this on YouTube for every 10,000 views we get, another 24 hours.
Wow, so 10,000 views, another 24 hours.
Yes.
20,000 views, another 24 hours.
Yes.
Up to the whole week, I guess.
Up to a whole week until the next one comes out, which will be this one the next week.
Awesome. I love this Doco Tuesday thing. Share this with your family and friends. Every Tuesday, we're going to show a whole full-length documentary that has never before been on YouTube. At least not when we put it up. Other people have, so.
And also check us out on Teespring. We got shirts like this one. I don't think we have that one on
this
there.
This is actually a gift from another YouTuber named Bible Flockbox.
All right. So we got shirts on Teespring. And of course, check us out on Patreon where you can see how to support us. For as little as $1 a month, you can get early access. $5 a month, you get behind the scenes. $15 a month, supporters get a t-shirt. Exclusive, not this one. It's a different one. And it goes on up from there. And so we encourage you to check us out. Patreon.com/LittleLightStudios.
Awesome. Without that help, we can't keep doing this. So we need your support. Nope. God bless you guys. And we'll see you next time.
All right.
The writer of the 1978 Superman film is not shy about his intentional parallels to Christ.
On Krypton, I was intending it to be almost semi-biblical. And people spoke in very stilted, elegant English. The metaphor was clearly there when Jor-El sends Superman to Earth of God sending Christ to save humanity.
You will travel far, my little Kal-El.
Hence, Superman's real name is Kal-El, which the Hebrew translation means voice of God. Identical to the description of Jesus in the first chapter of John.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
The similarities between Superman and Jesus can be seen throughout the hero's graphic media. Superman was sent by his father from the heavens down to Earth as a helpless baby, arriving in a spaceship like Moses arrived in a basket. He was raised by common parents who, in the 1939 issue of Action Comics number 1, his mother's name was Mary. Her name was later changed to Martha. And according to the Comic Vine website, Superman's father's name is Jonathan Joseph Kent. Mary, Martha, John, and Joseph were all names of people surrounding the life of Jesus. And just like Jesus spent time in the wilderness before his earthly mission began, Superman spent time in a Siberian wilderness before his earthly mission began.
It's all about sacrifice. The world, I hear their cries. So what happens? He gets the knife in the side, and later he falls to the earth in the shape of a crucifix. It was kind of nailing you on the head, but I enjoyed that because I've always found the myth of Christ compelling and moving.
Obviously, it is self-apparent that Superman was created to be a type of Christ. But what type of Christ is he really? His archenemy is Lex Luthor. Lex is Latin for law. So here we have a character that is fancied like a god who fights against the law, which is precisely the description of the Antichrist, someone who takes the place of Christ, but is far from the character of him. If Superman was an allegory for Jesus, then this comic of a demon-possessed Superman who gets tired of serving the human race and proceeds to destroy them would not fit the bill. Superman is not here to save you from your sins, but rather to save you from the tyrannical oppressing powers at hand, a myth we are all too familiar with. The Man of Steel is not the only comic character to have parallels to the Bible. We've already heard.
His iconography is that of a demon.
DC Comics recently put out a Batman issue, number 666, by writer Grant Morrison. According to the DC Comics wiki, the cover art is a depiction of Batman with a Hotel Bethlehem burning all around him. Note, Jesus was born in a manger, just outside a hotel in Bethlehem. The story is riddled with occult symbols and blasphemous imagery, even going as far as saying Batman sold his soul to the devil. So if Batman is clearly a depiction of a demon, who then is he fighting against? As a result of the Egyptian influence upon the superheroes, the mystery religion has been interwoven in the storylines since Batman's first appearance on TV in the 1960s. King Tut was a reoccurring character whose lair was in the Pyramid Club. Even Egyptian idols found their way into the sets. In Tim Burton's 1992 Batman Returns, the villain called the Penguin is thrown into a river in a basket when he was a newborn baby, a direct parallel to the biblical story of Moses. David Hughes picks up on the Moses insinuations, stating in his book titled Comic Book Movies that
the Ghost Rider Strick gained inspiration from a Moses parallel that had Penguin killing the firstborn sons of Gotham.
Ah, it's time. These are the names of the firstborn sons of Gotham City, just like I was. And like me, a terrible fate waits for them.
Inverting the biblical account of Moses and making him evil is a clue to the identity of Batman. Moses shares common attributes with Christ, as does Batman's enemies, as if they want the audience to believe that Christ is actually evil. This is why the filmmakers chose to make the Penguin's birth at Christmas time and his death at age 33 years old, an obvious parallel to the birth and death of Jesus Christ. In Batman Forever, we also see biblical imagery, especially in Two-Face's lair, when he meets the Riddler for the first time. The artwork on the back wall of Two-Face's hideout is of Jesus with a crown of thorns around his head. There is a seven-lamp candlestick, smoking incense, a burning animal, and a table with food on it. The very elements, which were associated with the Hebrew sanctuary, elements of God's great plan to get rid of sin. The sacrifice outside in the courtyard represents Christ's sacrifice. The seven-lamp candlestick represents the seven phases of the church. The table of showbread represents the Word of God, the incense smoke rising, emblematic of our prayers ascending into heaven. And the purpose of the sanctuary was for Christ to dwell among us here on earth. So it seems fitting that the dualistic character of Mr. Two-Face would have these elements in his dwelling place. Christ took on a sinful human nature, but was also a righteous God at the same time. A duality of existence, but yet he overcame his sinful human flesh. The Two-Face character seems to be a twisted inversion of a Christ type, which is seen more clearly in the movie, The Dark Knight, making you believe that the person who is meant to save the world is actually evil deep down inside. This so happens to be the occult view of Jesus Christ. And in the upside-down world of Batman, where the Dark Knight is the hero, Harvey Dent, who later becomes Two-Face, is known as the White Knight.
But I want your trust.
Well, you don't have to sell me, Dent. We all know you're Gotham's White Knight.
Another Christ-like parallel is that Harvey is a lawyer, one whose job is to uphold the law, a mediator in the courts, as Christ is our mediator, an advocate in the courts of heaven.
But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one.
The definition of an advocate is a defender in a court of law. Mr. Two-Face also shares similarities with the Sumerian god Isimud, a two-faced god depicted with his faces looking in opposite directions.
Victory is inevitable, for if knowledge is power, then a god.
And seeing that Osiris was known as an Egyptian Christ, the god associated with judgment, he also would be a natural enemy of Batman. Catwoman from the Batman series is an amalgamation of the Egyptian goddess Bast. This is heavily played upon in the 2004 Warner Brothers movie, Catwoman. In the opening seconds of the film, hieroglyphs and images of Bast are plastered across the screen, frames of cat cults, references to witchcraft, and the Egyptian Mao flash before the viewer's eyes. The storyline involves a woman who is resurrected from death by an Egyptian Mao, counterfeiting the breath of life God gave Adam in the book of Genesis. The cat then leads her to Ophelia Powers, a worshipper of Bast. Note the phrase, "Join us in the worshipping the cat goddess, Bast," at the top of her website. Ophelia reveals that the Egyptian Mao is a sacred cat of the temple who has resurrected many to be cat women.
The goddess Bast.
A picture of Michelle Pfeiffer, who played Selina Kyle in Batman Returns, links Bast to her version of Catwoman.
I am Catwoman. Hear me roar.
Perhaps the most iconic arch nemesis Batman ever faces is the Joker. The various Batman films have alluded to the Joker as being the devil.
You ever dance with the devil in the pale moonlight?
You ever dance with the devil by the pale moonlight?
Shall we dance?
Then the Joker dances in a church in the pale moonlight. On the surface, the Joker seems to leave hints that he is the devil. For example, when he passes out the cards, they have various images of devils, dragons, and snakes on them. The very description of Satan, the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil. Did you notice how only the Joker card is burning? From an occult perspective, it looks as though Jesus is the one who wants to watch the world burn.
Some men aren't looking for anything logical. They can't be bought, bullied, reasoned, or negotiated with. Some men.
The Joker was a man with no possessions.
Nothing. No matches on prints, DNA, dental. Clothing is custom, no labels. Nothing in his pockets but knives and lint. No name.
Jesus also had no earthly possessions.
Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head.
Sick men were drawn to the Joker.
He's a paranoid schizophrenic, former patient at Arkham, the kind of mind the Joker attracts.
He healed many who were sick with various diseases, and cast out many demons. And he did not allow the demons to speak.
The Joker also claims to heal a man who claims to hear voices.
The boss said he'd make the voices go away. He said he'd go inside and replace them with bright lights. Like Christmas.
Jesus is the one who separates the good and evil people for judgment, as does the Joker.
At midnight, I blow you all up.
If, however, one of you presses the button, I'll let that boat live. So, who's it gonna be? Harvey Dent's most wanted scumbag collection, or the sweet and innocent civilians?
All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life.
Batman's universe is like viewing the world through Satan's Gnostic eyes, where everything is upside down. A clue into who the writers had in mind when they designed the Joker is the origin of the cards he hands out. They aren't playing cards. Rather, they are tarot cards. In fact, the climax of the movie between the Joker and Batman is layered with terror imagery. At the midnight hour, the fate of the just and the unjust will be decided, a reference to the judgment at the prophetic midnight hour. Batman hurls the Joker off the roof just in time to save the day, only to wheel him back up from his left leg. Suspended between two posts, the Joker has his arms stretched out in a crucifixion pose. With the camera angle reorientating him right side up, he has the appearance of Christ hanging on the cross, much like the tarot card called the Hangman, which has a man hanging in the shape of an upside-down cross. According to tarotteachings.com, the Hangman means sacrifice, surrender, submission, and in between, or mediator. Characteristics that are descriptive of Jesus Christ. Many tarot card websites mention this connection. The Joker card is reputed to be based on the tarot card, The Fool. Even Grant Morrison, the writer of the Batman comic series Arkham Asylum, points out in his book Super Gods.
At the heart of The Dark Knight was a reputation-assuring performance that seemed to burn and fizz off the screen. It was hard to recognize the face of handsome young Heath Ledger under the scars and smeared makeup of the Joker. But he owned the screen from the moment he first appeared and slammed a pencil through a man's head until his final dangling turn as the Hanged Man of the Tarot, condemning Batman to an upside-down world of darkness and madness.
Ironically, the very next movie Heath Ledger was working on when he overdosed on drugs had a scene where he died by hanging, and the Hanged Man tarot card is shown. Grant Morrison admits earlier in the Super Gods book that he introduced heavy tarot meanings in the Batman franchise as he wrote for DC Comics. For example, making the Joker a holy fool, the cosmic Joker modeled after the tarot card called the Fool, another description of Jesus. The occult labels Jesus Christ the greatest cosmic joke.
Jesus became the scapegoat figure. There, mocked and spat upon like the goat dedicated to Azazel, the demon of the desert, on the Day of Atonement.
Inverting the biblical account and making him evil. Now you can see why the imagery of the only card burning in the dark night is the Joker. From an occult perspective, it isn't the dragon, that old serpent, the devil who burns. It's Jesus. The entire Batman series is essentially a Luciferian view that the devil is the savior, a viewpoint that holds true to many superhero storylines. Take, for instance, the Marvel movie Thor. The movie starts out with a depiction of a city of gold, which resembles a peaceful heavenly environment. Pay attention to the terminology.
I have sacrificed much to achieve peace. Thor, through your arrogance and stupidity, you have opened these peaceful realms and innocent lives to the horror and devastation of war.
You are a vain, greedy, cruel boy.
And you are an old man and a fool!
You're unworthy!
Father.
I now take from you your power! And I cast you out!
Please, open your eyes.
Oh, no, this is Earth, isn't it?
Where did it come from?
There is only one who's the epitome of greed and vanity, who traded peace for war and was cast down to Earth.
Your ancestors called it magic. And you call it science. I come from a place where they're one and the same.
He has disobeyed his king. His fate is in his own hands now.
I will end this.
A parallel story to Lucifer disobeying his father and king, once again making him the hero, the savior of Earth. Another noteworthy point is that magic was equated to science, where they are one and the same, erasing the line that divides them. This is a common thread that not only runs through the various storylines, but is at the heart of the comic writers. Alan Moore, who has written Batman, Superman, The Watchmen, and V for Vendetta, is a practicing magician that incorporates magic in all his stories.
On my 40th birthday, rather than merely bore my friends by having anything as mundane as a midlife crisis, I decided it might be more interesting to actually terrify them by going completely mad and declaring myself to be a magician. This had been something that had been coming for a while. It seemed to be a logical end step in my career as a writer. And the problem is that with magic, being in many respects a science of language, you have to be very careful what you say. There is some confusion as to what magic actually is. I think that this can be cleared up if you just look at the very earliest descriptions of magic. Magic, in its earliest form, is often referred to as the art. I believe that this is completely literal. I believe that magic is art, and that art, whether that be writing, music, sculpture, or any other form, is literally magic. Art is, like magic, the science of manipulating symbols, words, or images to achieve changes in consciousness. The very language of magic seems to be talking as much about writing or art as it is about supernatural events. A grimoire, for example, the Book of Spells, is simply a fancy way of saying grammar. Indeed, to cast a spell is simply to spell, to manipulate words, to change people's consciousness. And I believe that this is why an artist or writer is the closest thing in the contemporary world that you are likely to see to a shaman.
Alan Moore is a writer and magician from Northampton. He's a stranger to hairdressers and worships his very own god in his very own way, blurring the lines between religious belief, magic, and the power of the creative imagination. Alan's familiar on his journey of faith and worship is an ancient Roman glove puppet snake called Glycon.
How did you first go about worshipping Glycon, and what form does the worship take?
Well, it's irresistible. He's certainly the coolest, most rock and roll looking god that I have ever seen. I just fell in love at first sight.
What's in it for you, though, following Glycon?
We're all of us different emotionally, we're all different physically, intellectually. It would be really odd if we were all the same spiritually. So, I mean, that's why I have a problem with religion per se, because religion, the very word, it comes from the same root word as ligature and ligament, and it means to be bound together in one belief, which I find a bit creepy and a bit unnatural. There are genuine worries that, certainly in America, that this could actually negate science, it could drag us back into a new Dark Ages.
Alan Moore uses occult magic in all his work and openly admits riding under the state of possession.
I decided I was going to become a magician. All of a sudden, the lightning bolt hit. It all got a bit strange. For months after that, I was, looking back, probably in some borderline schizophrenic state. I found myself seemingly in conversation with an entity, its presence that surrounded my head, moving and speaking lucidly to me. I was very spaced out, godstruck. You babble for a while like an idiot. I must have been unbearable for 2 or 3 months. I've integrated that into the rest of my life.
His primary target is the youth, which he aims to indoctrinate with the occult.
And you've got kids who are supposed to make some sense of this huge and imposing world that's looming over us, when they've barely been able to make sense of the world that we've had for the past 20 years. And to do that, I don't really think personally the education system's up to it. What I think is that people these days get their information from all of the much despised sort of vulgar media sources that people have been trying so hard to ban for the past 40 years. Television, movies, comics, rock and roll records. That is the main way that kids sort of soak up all this info. So if in these sort of basically silly sort of funny books and things I can actually get over some information, if I can help the education process in a bright, four-colour comic book way that kids are actually going to want to read, then I'd say that's enough of a contribution. If I thought I'd done that, I think I'd be happy.
Two of the comic industry's biggest names to have written for Superman and Batman, Grant and Alan, are heavily involved in demonic activity. In a documentary about Grant Morrison titled Talking with Gods, artists who have worked with Grant testify to his involvement with the magic arts.
In addition to comics, one of the things that Morrison's known for is his interest in magic, specifically chaos magic. The idea that by believing in something, you can make it real. He'll talk about the rituals he'll perform and then seeing if they produce results in the real world. And for Morrison, they have.
Grant's take on magic for the most part has been to say, it's really easy, you just do this and results will happen. I did it, and it happened for me.
There's probably nobody on Earth who want to learn more about magic or expanding your consciousness than Grant Morrison.
First time I tried a magic ritual, I was 19, and I'd been given a book by my Uncle Billy, who was interested in Crowley, and he was the same guy that sort of gave me my first comic books. So he was a big formative influence.
Alistair was the father of modern Satanism. It was his philosophies that brought the occult into the mainstream pop culture. Many of Hollywood's biggest names were followers of him. Newspapers in his day deemed him the wickedest man alive. Grant Morrison's autobiography, Super Gods, he says when he was 19, his uncle gave him not only Crowley's Book of Thoth, but also a copy of Crowley's Tarot deck. Shortly after, Grant opened himself up to the occult, performing his first ritual by invoking his spirit in the form of a lion.
I tried this ritual, I did the whole thing, I got the candles out, I did the magic words, I did the circle, I did the banishings and all that stuff. And I stopped and I went to bed, and then this thing happened when I was lying down. And right in front of me there was a kind of gravitational point in the air in the room which was drawing all the perspectives towards it as if there was a hole there or a crack. And there was the sense of black oil filling up the folds between the brain. I just freaked out and called in the gods of my mum and dad, you know, Jesus, they would get me out of this one. And the whole experience ended after a little bit. And then there was this vision of a lion's face which started to announce stuff. So it seemed pretty convincingly Crowleyan to me that I'd actually somehow activated whatever it was he was talking about.
This became part of Grant's everyday life.
I came past his room to see if he wanted a drink. And it took a while for the door to open. And when it did, it creaked open slowly. And I could see Grant, who appeared to be wearing nothing but a grey blanket, tugged over his head. I said, "Do you want to come out for a drink?" I said, "No, I'm writing. I'm having breakthroughs." And then the door closed again, and the thing is, I didn't see him touch it. It just closed all on its own.
Grant's far-reaching influence has not only affected the comic book community, but his work has inspired some of Hollywood's largest franchises.
In 1999, The Matrix comes out, and it's obviously hugely influential. But if you look at The Matrix, a lot of the details, the style of The Matrix, and a lot of the cosmology of The Matrix basically comes from The Invisibles.
Well, this is the same story. They're wearing the same clothes that I'm currently sitting watching this wearing. But the first thing I remember about it is just how much I loved it and thought, what a great movie. They've got really rich by doing my stuff.
I think The Matrix owes Grant Morrison everything. Did I just say that? Wow, I just said that.
And then a little bit after that, I thought, no, this is what you wanted. This was the whole idea of doing The Invisibles, the hypersigil, so this would catch on. And weird Gnostic ideas would get out into the general populace and make them think differently.
I first read Grant's work on Animal Man number one. I'd recognized the character from like Who's Who and stuff, and I read that first issue and I was blown away. That was like one of the best comics I'd ever read in my life.
In Grant's book, Super Gods, he says,
"I came out in boils, a traditional sign of demon contact. I hallucinated something I recognized immediately as Christ. I understood that this power I was facing was some kind of Gnostic Christ, a Christ of the Apocrypha, an almost pagan figure that I'd found at the bottom at the last gasp."
You know, I'd become the character, I was wearing the clothes, I was going to the places, I was doing the things, I was doing the rituals, I was hanging out with the gods, and then putting it back in the comic, and then being affected by what was in the comic. So yeah, I mean, in terms of reality, that one was the actual deal, you know, that one was bringing me to the verge of death.
When Grant was working on The Invisibles, he got sick right around the time that character got sick.
Just after King Mob had been convinced by the bad guys that he'd been given a necrotizing fasciitis bacteria that was eating through his face, I suddenly get this huge boil on my face, and within 3 days it's enormous, distorted my entire feature. I was sweating constantly, I was getting into fevers and having these like shakes and rigors and then freezing. I just couldn't get up anymore, and I lay
in front of the fireplace in my house.
I mean, he thought he was going to die. I mean, he broke down in tears, and he was like, he was delirious, man, delirious.
And suddenly this giant column of light comes through the door. I mean, bear in mind, I'm hallucinating, but this was one of the most amazing hallucinations I've ever had. And it's Jesus. The first thing he said, which is the thing I put in the comic, just this voice suddenly announced itself. I am not the God of your fathers, I am the hidden stone that breaks all hearts. So then he's saying to me, okay, you're about to die now, but you don't have to die. And I said, look, I really don't want to die. What do I have to do? And he said, well, if you want to stay here, you have to work for us. You know, you have to spread the light.
This Gnostic light that Grant agreed to propagate has been effectively spread, much like a religion.
You know, being fans of something, be it from Buffy to Superman to anything else, the real diehard fans, I think there's almost a reason that they call us all disciples in a weird way, because I do think there's that connection of mythology that we almost take it so personally, because it is, in a lot of weird ways, you know, and people are going to hate me for saying this, religion or mythology. It's our guideline for to get our moral code and our integrity and our courage. We actually use them as a basis. And then it made me think, well, if that's the case, and it actually is, like, pop culture is actually the new mythology. So if that's the case, like, what a crazy power that any of us wield. I had described it to him as, it's almost like you're doing an ongoing series of the Bible.
If Grant, along with the comic book industry, is writing an ongoing series of the Bible, and Grant does so under the guidance of a Gnostic Christ, what is his biggest contribution?
In the late 80s, Morrison was working on Animal Man and Doom Patrol. Both of those series were great, critically acclaimed, but they weren't starring popular characters necessarily. But then he comes out with Arkham Asylum, which features Batman.
A friend of mine and I had been thinking about and talking about, just if, imagine you got to do Batman, this is what we would do.
It's not sitting there relying on being this pulpy action thing. That's what most people expect out of Batman. And here he's giving you this psychological drama.
But it got published just at the time that Tim Burton's Batman movie was coming out. And so the sales in this thing were immense.
His work on Superman redefine the character to some extent. In All-Star Superman, he presents in 12 issues sort of the definitive Superman story.
He was here at the convention a couple years ago, and somebody said, so All-Star Superman 10, does that mean that Superman is God? I said, yeah, Superman loves you. Didn't that make you feel good? He's a more proactive God.
Possibly his biggest contribution is taking characters like Batman and Superman, characters already imbued with occult and biblical meaning, and retelling the events surrounding Armageddon, or in biblical terms, the second coming of Christ.
The big climax to Grant's run near the end of the 90s was World War III.
Didn't realize you had a dark side, Clark.
Doesn't everybody?
Yeah, I guess so.
His friend Lana says,
so what are you, man or Superman?
An obvious reference to the philosopher that inspired the hero. In the season one episode titled Reaper, Lex Luthor said,
do you know what my father gave me for my 10th birthday? A copy of The Will to Power. Behold the Superman. Man is something to be overcome. Sun Tzu, Machiavelli, Nietzsche.
And in the final season of Smallville, in an episode called S.H.I.E.L.D., Lois Lane has a conversation with another character about Nietzsche's concept of the Superman, which is quoted directly from Nietzsche's Sprach Zarathustra, the book from which the prophecy of the Übermensch is explained. The Superman he is to be a replacement.
You know, the philosopher Nietzsche believed we shouldn't live for the future, but for the present. He thought that people who chased after some far-off future dream were really running away from their true destiny.
Yeah, well, Nietzsche can call me a chicken if he wants, but he has never dated someone like Clark.
It wouldn't have mattered. To him, the true hero was the person who embraced the life that he or she was given and made it better. He called that person Übermensch.
A Superman.
Nietzsche believed that all of us could be one,
In Smallville, as in all Superman retellings, Superman is sent down to Earth out of the heavens by his father. Jesus is raised by his working-class family and... Jesus is crucified on a cross, naked and humiliated on the outskirts of Jerusalem. Clark Kent is crucified, almost naked, on a cross on the outskirts of Smallville. But unlike Jesus, Clark Kent doesn't die on the cross. The Jews were expecting a political savior and mocked Jesus on the cross, reasoning that if he were the hero they had been expecting, that he would use miracles, brute strength, or outside help to save himself. After all, how could he be their savior, their hero, if he was dead? But this is because they completely misunderstood what Jesus had come to do. He came to pay the penalty of sin, and that penalty wasn't a Roman cross. It was being separated from God. That's why Jesus said, "My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" The cross could not stop Jesus. Physical death could not stop him. Thus, Jesus had no interest in coming off the cross. It wouldn't accomplish anything. The knowledge that the anger of God was upon Jesus to pay the penalty of the wickedness of humanity was what killed him, not the cross. In fact, they marveled to discover he died so soon. Crucifixion often took days.
"We are confident you will become Earth's greatest."
But Clark Kent, in this twisted retelling of the crucifixion of Jesus, this Christ-like figure, doesn't die or even stay on the cross. This was a hero the Pharisees were looking for. A political hero. A temporal hero. A strong man to overthrow the powers that oppress us, and nothing more. Clark Kent's story, then, is a thinly veiled retelling of the story of Jesus.
"You need to see a doctor."
Including Superman going around doing good deeds, saving people. Even the show's theme song is called "Save Me" by Remy Zero. All one has to do is go to google.com and search for Superman Jesus, or smallville.wiki.com and search for Jesus, and pages of parallels can be found, more than there is room to include in the scope of this video. The first season of Smallville parallels content from the books Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, reimagining the birth and crucifixion of Jesus. And the final scene's climax is like Armageddon from the book of Revelation. Superman's subtle pagan influences, such as sun worship, are written into his storylines. On Krypton, the world where Superman comes from, the sun is worshipped as the god Ra, not all that different from the sun god Ra of Egypt. In fact, in certain versions of the comic book, Superman is a Ra worshipper. In Smallville, a special book appears named the Book of Ra, the Kryptonians' version of the Bible, which contains Ra's prophecy.
"The Book of Ra. The Book of Ra.
We need the Book of Ra.
What do you want from me?"
"Everything you know about the Book of Ra."
"It's the Kandorian Bible."
"Zod said the Book of Ra was some sort of Kryptonian Bible."
"It's so much more than that. It wields great power."
"The Book of Ra."
"The scrolls of Ra have foretold of one who will rise from the ashes and start anew in paradise, where he will live as a god among men."
This is made to be a parallel to the Bible's Book of Revelation, foretelling the way Christ shall return a second time to earth. But something happens. Somehow this Book of Ra opens up a portal in the universe for the apocalypse to take place.
"It's no surprise that Zod would lie. The Book of Ra is not a Bible."
As a note, it is a misunderstanding to think the word apocalypse means the end of the world. In fact, it doesn't mean that at all. That's just the meaning society has given it. The word apocalypse only means to reveal or to unveil.
The word apocalypse means revelation. That's all it means. Although it has come to mean end of the world.
The Smallville Apocalypse is not a book or something being revealed, but a fictional planet that is descending to Earth in a mockery of the second coming of Jesus.
According to the journals, the apocalypse is an actual planet and it's coming.
It is said in the Book of Revelation that God's city, the New Jerusalem, known as Heaven, will descend out of the heavens following a sequence of events. In Smallville, the planet Apocalypse is coming, ruled by an evil overlord named Darkseid. It is stated point blank in the final episode of this series that Darkseid is Lucifer and Satan, meaning that this is a reversal of the Bible, with Satan arriving for the second coming instead of Jesus.
Hades, Kali, even the word Lucifer is an old Latin phrase meaning morning star, bringer of light. I'm afraid the centuries and translations have twisted Darkseid's true gifts.
Darkseid's three prophets, which parallels the three false prophets of Revelation, prepare the hearts of people around the world, offering them eternal life, salvation, and a place in the rapture when Darkseid returns.
I've done what?
Our work is done.
Say that again.
That's impossible.
I got this friend. Cool leather jacket, blurs faster than a speeding bullet. He's pretty good at impossible.
You were so close to experiencing the rapture. Known only to those who will be serving our Lord for eternity. While all the others perish, do you really think you possess the power to vanquish our Lord from the souls of those he saved?
No. But I got friends in high place.
Darkseid is Lucifer, and he is taking for himself the attributes of Jesus. Interestingly, in this story, it's Darkseid that's the moral savior. Or, in this case, two Christ-like figures fighting against each other. Both have features of the Antichrist. One is the Antichrist, the other is the Antichrist that's coming in the end times.
Darkseid
makes Jesus into Satan, therefore also making Superman a Satan becoming a Christ. They're intending you to look at the real Jesus as a villain.
You see, that all relies on you saving us from the coming apocalypse.
You know about Darkseid?
You really think I just read the cliff notes of the Veritas journals? They foretold of a chosen savior.
This has been part of the devil's agenda for thousands of years. The Book of Revelation states that Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega. Most people may think they are familiar with the Mark of the Beast, but most don't realize that the Mark of the Beast is Satan's counterfeit to the seal of God, which marks the foreheads of God's followers at the end of time. The symbol of the Greek letter Omega begins to appear on people's foreheads, similar to the seal of God, instead of 666, which would be the mark of the beast. But in the end, Superman flies up, stops the second coming from taking place, and removes the seal of God from everyone's foreheads. Nietzsche said we need no God. We only need Übermensch, the Superman. So it's fitting that Smallville ends with Superman defeating the second coming of a God who offers a world salvation. Over 2,000 years ago, Satan was extremely successful in deceiving the world about the true nature of God, that when he sent his only son, the world did not recognize him. Throughout the Dark Ages, the church was enshrouded with gross misconceptions of God's love. Truth was mixed with pagan beliefs. Corruption and myth was traded for the gospel. Here in the 21st century, the deceptions haven't changed. They have only intensified. The characters in the stories have transformed, but the core of the lie has always rang through, that the gods of this world are the heroes, and the God of heaven is the evil villain. The use of magic is interwoven in the stories as well as the lives of the artist. Blatant use of demonic assistance is welcomed in conjuring up these ludicrous stories. Could it be that all of these mythological retellings are part of a greater master plan to subtly weave thoughts of doubt and dissension into the world, getting us to side with the fallen angels that were cast down to this earth? If Satan counterfeits everything that God does, it would only make sense that he would copy and confuse one of the greatest supernatural events this world will ever witness, the Second Coming. As a result of the world being entertained with a false view of who Christ really is and filled with fantastical visions of what the end of the world will be like, many who are not diligently searching the Bible to have a meaningful relationship with Christ will easily be deceived when Satan reveals himself. Do not be deceived by these master magicians. If demonic entities are involved in the formulation of these comics, then they must have a plan. All of these fictitious heroes are influencing the world to seek a savior that is unlike the King of Heaven. They are preparing the world to desire characteristics that are the same in Lucifer, the god of this world. There is only one superhero that we should desire. A character that deserves our greatest attention, the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.